Weight loss gang, let's get this bread. In the last 20 years, obesity prevalence has increased by 12% and severe obesity has increased by 5%. The weight loss industry in America is on fire. And in 2022, the US weight loss market share hit a whopping $135 billion and is expected to skyrocket to $305 billion by 2030, growing by a cool 10% annually. Some folks even say that it might go as high as $405 billion, according to Global Newswire. A lot of people out here really want your money, but I'll help you out for free, which, by the way, is my favorite price. My name is Tejas, and I'm a certified nutritionist and personal trainer, and I am super passionate about empowering people with the knowledge and resources to enable them to live healthier and happier lives. In today's video, we are going to dive into a new evidence-based weight loss model that can enable us to develop killer weight loss strategies and healthy habits that will sustain this weight loss. Prior to jumping in today's video, I want to mention that I'm a huge fitness enthusiast, deeply passionate about empowering people with the knowledge to make smart steps to improve their health and growth goals. In my videos, I always like to provide context and actionable information to provide concrete steps that people can take to advance their well-being. I want to stress that these tips are never one size fit all, and it is important that any lifestyle shifts that you are unsure of, you consult with a healthcare professional, registered dietitian, and most importantly, listen to your body because you know yourself better than anyone else. In general, I am a big advocate of making small steps and routinely checking in with your mind and your body prior to making any major lifestyle change. That all said, let's get to it. Today, the most popular weight loss ideology is the calorie model. It's simple, it's generalizable, and it's backed by the American Heart Association, which is pretty cool. In a scientific statement by the AHA in 2021, adjusting energy intake and expenditure was cited as a key factor in achieving and maintaining a healthy body weight. The model ascribes the fattening effect of food exclusively to the number of excess calories consumed. Let's break it down. Basically, there are a few equations to think about. I know I say equations, but they're simple and really worth internalizing, so stick with me. First, the change in body weight is equal to the difference between calories in and calories out. Calories are basically a unit of energy, and if you take in more excess energy in the form of calories, you will gain weight. And if you intake less, then you will lose weight. Pretty intuitive. Generally speaking, calories in is pretty easy to monitor because you can really only take in calories from your mouth. Calories out, though, is quite hard to intuitively track because this not only happens while we exercise, but also it happens while we go about our day and live our lives. In fact, most of the calories that we burn happen without us knowing. This uncertainty warrants a second equation. We can break calories out, or total energy expenditure, abbreviated TDEE, into three major categories. The first is resting metabolic rate, which is just the energy that you burn when you're just chilling. You actually burn a majority of your calories, around 60 to 75%, this way. The second is the thermic effect of food. The thermic effect of food is the calories burned in the digestion of food. And don't get too excited. The amount of calories burned generally does not exceed the amount of calories taken in. The different thermic effects of different foods correlate to how hard your body needs to work to break it down into a form your body can use. If we look at the different macronutrients, protein increases metabolic rate by 20 to 30%, carbs 5 to 10%, and fat 0 to 3%. Finally, the thermic effect of physical activity refers to all of the calories burned during physical activity. And this includes both structured exercise, like hitting the gym, or unstructured exercise, like walking up the stairs. This accounts for 15 to 30% of calories burned during the day. But what are calories? When we talk about weight, we typically speak in terms of pounds. And that brings us to the final piece of the puzzle. 3,500 calories is equivalent to 1 pound. So let's see how we can apply this calorie model to weight loss. Let's say that I'm a 5'9" male that weighs 180 pounds and I'm 25 years old working a desk job. First, let's look at calories out, or the total daily energy expenditure. First, we need to set a goal. What do we want our daily change in body weight to be? If we shoot for 1 pound a week, then we would divide 3,500 calories, which is 1 pound, into 7 days, resulting in negative 500 calories per day, or a seventh of a pound per day. Next, we would need to look at total daily energy expenditure, or calories out. Thankfully, this is really easy to approximate using online, free, my favorite price, TDEE calculators. These calculators use basic anatomical features to provide an approximate TDEE that represents the average daily energy expenditure of someone with those specs. And let's look at an example.
All right, so I had the TDEE calculator pulled up here, and I've entered a male, 25 years old, 180 pounds, 5'9", and activity level pretty sedentary, having an office job, just as in the description. One thing you'll notice as well is that they have support for metric units as well in this calculator, but we're gonna go with imperial for now because I'm the United States and I know these numbers offhand. So we can see here that the maintenance calories is 2150, which is the amount of calories that your body naturally burns per day, and also the amount of calories that you need to eat to maintain the weight that you have. At the bottom, we can see ideal weight and BMI score, which are really more so recommendations and should definitely be taken with a grain of salt because everyone's body type is different.
Finally, we can turn our attention to calorie intake. We just need to make sure that what we eat falls below this number. In the example, 1650 calories a day. We would need to figure out a way to track the calories of each item we consume. And we can track the calories of foods through consulting the nutrition labels of food we consume or checking online. I actually highly recommend MyFitnessPal, which is an amazing one-stop shop for calorie counting and keeping track of them, with over 18 million items listed. If you're eating out, you can check out a menu at the establishment, or MyFitnessPal might even have the number that you're looking for. Pretty much everything here checks out mathematically, but there is one fundamental assumption that is being made here. People often erroneously assume the restricted caloric intake will not change the energy expenditure as well. In reality, both energy expenditure in addition to body weight will change. We can't just isolate one variable. An overwhelming amount of research over the last century points to how reducing food intake leads to the body adapting naturally to burn fewer calories. In other words, your body's resting metabolic rate, which is a majority of your daily energy expenditure, is reduced when you eat at a deficit. So back in 1944, there was an experiment called the Minnesota Starvation Experiment. This study had two goals. The first was that it aimed to create a comprehensive guide on how prolonged famine-like semi-starvation conditions affect healthy men physically and mentally. It also explored the effectiveness of dietary rehabilitation for those that are in this condition. Secondly, the scientific findings were intended to help allied relief efforts in providing assistance to famine victims after World War II. They found out that when people cut their calorie intake by 50% and ate low-fat, low-protein, and high-carb foods, their resting metabolic heart rate dropped by 40%, and not only this, but their body temperature, respiration, and heart rate also went down. Their bodies effectively downshifted all processes to account for this scenario. Half a century later, a comprehensive 29-study meta-analysis examined the impact of calorie restriction on metabolic rate, and the results are reflected by the data points in this graph. As we can see, nearly every data point in this graph reflects a reduced metabolic rate, indicated by these points below the zero on the y-axis. One other interesting point to note is that as the duration of the study increases, we see a reduced resting metabolic rate over time, suggesting that the body further adapts to this net reduced energy expenditure over time by naturally expending less energy. 30 years after that, another smaller meta-analysis examined 6 studies that prescribed people to restrict their calories by 25%, further supporting this theory. The solid line represents how much food the participants ate. We can see that over the duration of these experiments, they did not adhere to the full 25% calorie restriction. But over the year, participants did operate at 12% calorie restriction, which is still pretty commendable to keep up after a year. What is super interesting, though, is that the dotted line, which represents total daily energy expenditure, eventually naturally meets this line. Despite consistently eating fewer calories that would have resulted in a decrease in body weight at the start of the experiments, the subjects eventually maintained weight due to the reduced energy expenditure attached with weight loss. With all these experiments, it is clear that taking in less energy naturally signals our body to reduce energy expenditure, and this makes a lot of sense. When times are tough, our body operates more efficiently and hunkers down to keep you alive. But this natural response can lead to body weight plateaus that can get in the way of a successful weight loss plan. The key question from all of this is clear. How can we minimize the effect of the body's reduction in energy expenditure while eating fewer calories? And to solve this, enter the information model. The information model, also known as the hormone model, is a more comprehensive weight loss model that provides a more complete picture than the calorie model. So often, when we simplify weight loss, it is easy to fixate on how weight loss comes down to just improving discipline through avoiding poor diet choices, being more active, and reducing meal frequency. The hormone model takes this one step further and reframes inactivity and poor diet choices as a symptom of a hormone imbalance, and this hormone imbalance leading us to feel the strong urge to make the choices that prevent weight loss. And reframing this helps us work smarter, not harder, or equally hard for better results. Under the information model, when we eat, it's not just about the number of calories, it also involves the content of those calories. There is information that is packaged with different types of calories that affects whether our body burns fat or not, leading to changes in resting metabolism in both the short and long term. The specific hormone that this model is concerned with is insulin, and the specific macronutrient, carbohydrates. When we eat carbs, our body turns them into glucose molecules. Then the pancreas releases insulin, which is a hormone that helps use a small portion of those carbs as energy, but mostly stores them for later. Basically, insulin tells the body to do three things. First, stop glycolysis. Your body is naturally burning down glycogen, which is a storage form of carbohydrates stored as a body fat. When insulin is active, you can't burn this fat for fuel, and your metabolic rate goes down. The second is it stimulates fatty tissue growth. This means it makes more fatty tissue to store any extra energy from the glucose. And finally, it burns a small amount of the glucose that you consumed for energy. Having insulin consistently present in the body throughout the day can severely impact weight loss efforts by reducing your metabolic rate due to these processes continually being active. This keeps your body in a state of mainly stopping the fat burning and building fatty tissues for long periods of time. And this principle is important to bear in mind when crafting an effective weight loss plan. Let's go back to our case example. So remember, in the hypothetical case study, I want to lose 10 pounds and I have a total energy expenditure of 2150 calories per day. The plan is to eat 1650 calories per day, creating a 500 calorie deficit each day. I'm aiming to keep this up for 10 weeks to match my goal of losing 10 pounds. Now we're going to check out two different meal plans with the same number of calories and see how they stack up in the context of the information model. In meal plan one, I eat many snacks throughout the day, and they're mostly very carb heavy. In meal plan two, I'll eat within an 8-hour window and reduce my carbohydrate intake in all of my meals. I really like to draw things out, so let's look at a diagram. Assuming I had this diet beforehand as well, we see that my body takes in on average 2150 calories per day, eat meals throughout the day, and expends 2150 calories. The body's fat stores don't need to be used as much since I am more or less operating at an energy balance. Now let's say that I cut 500 calories and maintain the same eating schedule. Well, what we see is that the high insulin levels throughout the day prevent glycolysis, in essence, preventing me from burning stored weight. This results in the body metabolism or energy expenditure naturally decreasing to match the reduced caloric intake. And this is highly consistent with the Ansel Keys study mentioned earlier. The participants in the study were fed at a 50% caloric deficit, eating low protein, high carbohydrate foods, and their naturally daily energy expenditure dropped dramatically in response. Now let's look at the second case. As before, prior to the diet beginning, my body takes on an average of 2150 calories per day. I eat meals throughout the day and I expend 2150 calories. When the calorie restriction is applied to this plan, the insulin supply in the body is reduced due to time-boxed food intake and foods that trigger minimal insulin release. This enables my body to go through glycolysis and maintain higher levels of energy expenditure despite reduced energy intake. My body is able to access those fat stores it was previously unable to due to the reduced insulin in the body. As we can see, the calorie model is legit. And the information model gives us a much more complete picture of how we can approach weight loss effectively. Bearing this in mind, let's go over some practical pieces of advice that can be used to lead or sustain weight loss and increase your energy. The first is intermittent fasting. Try eating within smaller time windows to give your body periods of reduced or zero insulin. This can help you burn more calories from your body fat reserves. The second, cut snacking. This is the same idea as fasting. If you can't avoid snacking altogether though, go for snacks that are lower in carbs for the same reason. Third, ditch the high glycemic foods. High glycemic foods cause a big insulin surge, which messes with the fat burning and promotes fat storage. Plus, it can lead to an insulin tolerance, making weight loss a real challenge. Stick to low glycemic foods like fruits, veggies, nuts, and less processed grains in general. And finally, pump up the protein and hit the weights. Building more muscle naturally bumps up your resting metabolic rate and helps you burn more calories even at rest. This is highly advantageous during weight loss, as the increased metabolism associated with a higher percentage of muscles can offset some of the reduced energy expenditure associated with the weight loss. In addition, although the calories burned during eating don't contribute significantly to weight loss, proteins require the most energy to digest per calorie, causing another slight bump to RMR. And here's the final word. Prior to ending today's video, I have to acknowledge that I have been bashing carbohydrates this entire video. And I want to mention that carbohydrates are not evil by any stretch of the imagination, and they are an essential macronutrient necessary for bodily functions and physical activity. There are a million different people offering you advice online. And the most important part is identifying the problems that you resonate with and making these small adjustments in your own life, and then routinely observing those results. I encourage you to continually monitor not only your desired visible changes, but also your baseline energy levels and your mood as you march onwards towards your goals. Cheers to our health, and I'll see you next time.